God bless you. May the Lord be with you and bless you in a very special way. We are going to continue to study God's word this morning. And as we've been studying it for a long time on the same subject of grace. And the Bible simply teaches, when we are kind of summarizing the teaching of the Bible into this particular expression, where we say grace takes you from where you are to where God wants you to be. Say that word with me. Grace takes me from where I am to where God wants me to be. If you say I'm already comfortable where I am, let me tell you, grace has much more comfortable place for you. If you say I'm doing good wherever I am, let me tell you, God can make you do better. Amen. And that's what grace does to each one of us in our Christian life. How does it work? How can we move on in the kingdom of God from one place to another where God has ordained it for us? How does grace work? We have been studying it for a long time from different dimensions. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 10 is what we are at, where Paul is saying, I am what I am by the grace of God. Then he goes on to say, the grace that God gave me was not in vain. Then he goes on to say, I labored much more than everybody else. In other words, he says, I took much more efforts, much more than everybody else, not in a competitive sense of the word. Again, he says, not I, but the grace of God that is with me. And here we are looking at the efforts that we need to take in order for progress to happen in our spiritual life. Many people have this wrong idea that the moment you become a Christian, things will automatically begin to change. Some have this hope that accidentally everything will change and one fine day I will be what I am. But that doesn't happen that way. The Bible gives very simple illustrations of how things work. The parable of the sower is very, very important. It is more the parable of the soil rather than the parable of the sower. And Jesus says, if you can't understand this parable, you will not understand the other parables. And he's saying it's very, very simple. What does the parable of the soil teach us? The soil is our heart. The word of God is the seed. And if there has to be any harvest of whatever kind in our life, the seed has to go into the soil. The soil has to guard it and with patience and perseverance has to bring it forth, and then there will be a harvest. You know, Jesus said, if you don't understand this simple logical connection, then you cannot understand the other parables. So the word has to go into our heart, and the heart has to hold it, and it will bring forth fruit. You know, it will bring forth a harvest. And whatever is being preached this morning, the word has to go into your heart, and your heart has to be a good heart. It has to protect it, and with perseverance, it has to bring forth fruit. As a result, what will happen? You will go from where you are to where God wants you to be. This is how kingdom of God works in its simplest form. So how does this progress come in our life? Paul says, I have taken effort. What kind of effort? You know, what is involved in all these efforts? I've already talked about instruction, correction, and we are looking into the loss of our labor. In other words, on what basis should we take the efforts that needs to be taken for our life to come to a level of prosperity and of understanding? So Paul says in the last week that we studied God's word, that if you are going to if a man is going to wrestle, he is going to wrestle according to the rules, only then will he be crowned, the Bible says. In other words, every game has got certain rules and certain regulations. You know, it is not by any way, hook or crook, I will get to my point. No, that's not what it is all about. Godly blessings will come only in godly ways. There is no other way. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father except through me. He may sound very arrogant, but that is the way, because he is the way and he is the only way. And you cannot say it any other way, in a very diplomatic way, as actually I am the only way. Please don't take it, you know, very seriously. I'm not being arrogant. No, he's the only way. And that is how we can say it. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father except through me. Hallelujah. So the Bible says, since he is the way, and godly blessings only come through godly ways. And last week we studied about one particular law, which says the law of obedience, which means, you know, we have been created to do good works. And what are those good works? In simple terms, it simply means we are created to do God's will. And we have to do God's will, and that is what is called the law of obedience. And we looked at it from Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1. Why am I giving such a long review? Because we want to be on the same page as we study today. Are you with me? So Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1, the Bible says that we have to run in the race that has been marked out for us. Meaning, the race that you run, nobody else is running. You are the only person in the track. Nobody is running ahead of you. Nobody is trying to overtake you. God has marked it out specially for you. In this spiritual race, everyone who runs can win. Amen. Everybody who runs can receive the crown. That is why Paul says, there is a crown of righteousness waiting for me, not just for me, but for everyone who desires the revelation of Christ. There is a crown of righteousness waiting for me. So you can be assured this morning, there is a crown waiting for you. A crown of righteousness. What is a crown of righteousness? A crown of righteousness simply means a crown that is given to a person for doing what is right. And that is why it is called the crown of righteousness. Why is righteousness very important? The Bible says God is a righteous God. In simple terms, God is always right. Say that word together with me. God is always right, and therefore he is righteous in that sense of the word. How am I going to apply those things into my life in order for me to receive what God has ordained for me? Come with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. We are going to look at the law of diligence this morning. The Bible says, without faith it is impossible to please God. And he who comes to God must believe that he exists, and he is a rewarder of those who seek him diligently. So what does this diligence all about? Why is it so important? How does it work? How does it practically apply into my life and into my situations? Come with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 24 onwards. Paul again is using the context of a race that happens and how you need to win. Hebrews 12 again talks about the race. 2 Timothy chapter 4, again Paul uses the context of a race. We are going to read God's word. 1 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 24. Do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may win. I will read it for you again. Do you not know that all those who run in a race, they all run, but only one will receive the prize? And Paul says, run in such a way that you will win. Say that those words together with me. Run in such a way that you may win. Say that again. Run in such a way that you may win. That is where diligence is all about. Paul says, on a race, everybody will be running. But he says, you need to run in such a way that you will win. You know, a car race driver, you know, was going for a very high-speed car race. And then he went to his grandmother and he said, would you bless me? I'm going to drive in a very fast car race. And the grandmother blessed him. God be with you. Paathu poppa, meduva po, avasara padada. You understand what I'm saying? You know, you need to drive carefully. Don't drive too fast. Be on the safer side. You know, her concern is very, very right. But anyone who drives in the race, they drive in such a way that they want to win. You know, there is a proverb in Tamil which goes like this. You know, I am Purushanam. My husband also went to the orchestra for English-speaking people. You have to translate that. I don't know how it kind of well translates. The whole point is, my husband also went, I also went, we were also part of the crowd. But Paul says, anybody who runs the race, everybody will be running. You know, there will be some kind of efforts from everybody's side. But Paul says, there has to be a distinction. He says, when you run, you need to run in such a way that you win. And that is very important. Every Sunday morning, all the Christians, where do they go to? Brookfields? No, they go to church on every Sunday morning. If you go back on your way back, every bus stand that you will look at, you will always see people standing with their Bibles on, you know, with their Bibles in their hand. For some reason, Sunday seems to be very good. Working day for me. But nevertheless, it is very good. You know, suddenly the sun seems to be shining brighter. And people look much more brighter on Sunday than on Monday. You understand what I'm trying to say? But every Sunday, everybody goes to church. And, you know, people will say, oh, this, you know, today is Sunday, I have to go to church. You know, that is a good kind of a formality to have. But everybody will go to church, but you need to go in such a way that you will come back having received from God. That is the key that needs to happen in our life. Everybody will listen to a sermon, but you need to listen in such a way, through the voice of the preacher, you will discern the voice of God in your life. Everybody will be reading the Bible, some to improve their knowledge, some to find what is wrong with the Bible, and some people just to know about it. But you read the Bible in such a way that through the words that you read, you will begin to hear the still small voice of the Holy Spirit, which will bring about healing in your life. And that is the attitude that you and I, we need to have when we do the things of God for the glory of God. Everybody will be singing. You know, we can also sing. But sing in such a way that God will be glorified and you will be edified. I'm going to say that again. Sing in such a way that God will be glorified and you will be edified. It is building up of our own self. And Paul puts a right kind of a tilt in our attitude that we need to have. When Paul says everybody will be running, but you need to run in such a way that you will win that particular race. Going again to a couple of verses down in verse 26, again he makes another comparison. Paul says, therefore I run in such a way as not without any aim. I box in such a way as not beating the air. In other words, let me kind of give you another translation which puts it like this. So I run with purpose. In every step I take, I am not just shadow boxing. In other words, Paul says, I run every step I take. It is a step of purpose towards a particular aim, towards a particular goal. In other words, I am not kind of, to use the kind of expression, simply doing this. You know, summa seigren. No, that is not the attitude. If you look at God, if you look at Christ, if you look at the word of God, and the Bible says, God, whatever he did, whenever he did it, he always did it for a purpose, and you and I, we are created in the image of God. Therefore, every step that we take needs to be a step of purpose in our life. Paul combines again two games in this particular verse of scripture. One is a race. I'm not running without any aim. I have a goal. I have a definite aim towards which I'm running my race. Then he gives you the example of boxing, you know. And that is when the Bible says, I will not be beating the air. In other words, I'm not doing any kind of shadow boxing. In other words, you and I, some of you might be aware how they kind of rate the boxing thing, you know. Last couple of months ago, there was a big important fight. And at the end of it, the guy who won the game or won the fight got $300 million. Is that not true? If they are going to give prize money for every fight we fight, we would have crossed $600 million in just our family alone. You understand? You understand what I'm trying to say? You know, in the boxing, there are different things happen. One they call the knockout, you know, where the guy hits the other guy and he hits the canvas, he never comes back. And that's a knockout game. But this particular game, after 12 rounds, both guys were standing tall. You know, nobody went to the canvas. Now they have a different way of rating the whole thing. So there are people who are sitting there with their pen and paper. They will be marking every punch they kind of throw at the opponent. And only those punches which land on them will carry what? Will points. And again, if you go below the chest, those punches, they don't what? They don't care and carry any points. After 12 rounds of constant fighting, they are now standing to see their marks. And sometimes what happens in the game, you know, instead of hitting the opponent, they will hit the umpire, the referee. You understand? Sometimes that happens in our life also. We are angry with somebody else, and the guy who came to help us, the referee, he got hit by us. You know, after hitting him, only then we realized, adam namakku udhavi seiya vandhaven. He came to help us. And sometimes a wife or a husband, God has given you as a helpmate. not as an opponent in the boxing ring. Are you with me? You know, sometimes that's what our nature seems to be like. Somebody says something against me, immediately I think them to be my competitor. I want to get myself, you know, back at them and so on and so forth. Probably what they said is supposed to help me through in my progress in my spiritual life. So they hit the referee at sometimes. Sometimes what they do is they, instead of trying to hit the opponent, they hit him so hard he kind of moves away the hand, does a full round and hits the guy himself. You know, self-inflicted wounds. These things do happen. But Paul says, I don't do shadow boxing. In other words, what is he saying is this: I know where my fight is. My fight is not against flesh and blood. Therefore, you know, I don't get angry with people. I don't take it out on them. And another place of scripture, the Bible says, they did so much harm to me. May it not be counted against them. You know, that is the attitude that Paul has. And he says, I don't do shadow boxing. I don't do a run without any purpose, because I run in such a way so that I can win the prize. And that is where diligence all comes about in that particular verse of scripture. Diligence has two important things which leads to excellence in our life. Number one is effectiveness. Effectiveness. It is simply doing what is right. Doing what is right. That is called effectiveness. And together with effectiveness is what is called efficiency. It is doing things right. You know, there is a small change in the way it is phrased, but there is a major distinction among both of it. Let me say that again. Effectiveness is doing the right thing. Say that word with me. Effectiveness is, oh, come on, you can do better. You all had breakfast, I'm sure. You know, let's say it again. Effectiveness is doing what is right. And efficiency is doing things right. When you do what is right and when you do it right, it will lead you to excellence, and that is the result of diligence in your life. If you are with me, say a big amen to that. How many of you want to be promoted? How many of you want to make progress in life? It doesn't come automatically. It doesn't come accidentally in your life. The Bible makes it very, very clear. You have to do what is right, which is doing the will of God. And you have to do it right, which is obeying the will of God in its fullest form, that will lead you to excellence in the kingdom of God. And that is how we can make progress in our life. Doing what is right, and you do it right, and that is what is expected of you and me, and that is what is called diligence also. If you go to the book of Haggai, chapter 1, verse 5, 6, and 7, the Bible, the prophet says like this. It starts in verse 5. Where the prophet says, God says, consider your ways, says the Lord. Again, in verse 7, the Bible says, consider your ways. What happened in verse 6 is what we are going to look at this morning. Number 5, it says, consider your ways. Again, God says, consider your ways. What is happening in their ways? Verse 6, you have sown much, but harvest little. You eat, but there is not enough to be satisfied. You drink, but there is not enough to become drunk. You put on clothing, but no one is warm enough. And he who earns wages to put it in a purse with holes. Here you find people, it's not that they are not taking any effort whatsoever. The Bible says they are taking effort, but they are not getting the expected results in their life. Now there are people here who can say, I have taken efforts that needs to be taken, but I'm not getting what I'm expecting in my life. And at that particular juncture, the prophet says, I want you to consider your ways. I want you to consider how you do things. So here it says, you are sowing much, but you are not reaping that much as you expect. And the Bible goes on to say, you are eating, but you are not what? Satisfied. You drink, but you are not, your thirst is not quenched. And you earn, and you come and put it in a purse, the Bible says, and it is a purse with lots of holes. And somebody came to me, he said, Pastor, I don't know where all the money goes. Now on the first of the month, it all comes in. By the 20th of the month, I don't know where it all went. So I encouraged him to follow a simple kind of an illustration. Get a piece of paper and write down every expenses that you ever make during the month. And he came back after making all note of all the expenses. 40% he has just eaten it away. Tinne thithirukkar. 40%. You know, now you know where your money went. You know, I don't know where it went. Satan eduthit pora enga pora. You understand what I'm trying to say? No. You know, the way, it is not that there is no effort whatsoever. There is an effort, but the problem is there is not expected returns. And the Bible says, consider your ways. I will say that again, consider your ways. And verse 8 gives you the reason why things were not working the way they need to be. And God says, you neglected my house and you are doing your own thing. And that is why all these things are happening in your life. In other words, what is he saying? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. What is my part of the job? My part of the job is to do the seeking, and God's part of the job is to do the adding bit. I am going to say that again. I do the seeking and God does the adding. Say it together with me. I do the seeking and God does the adding. But what we do is we sometimes kind of switch things over. We try to add things to our life. In doing so, we forget to seek God. That was this true story that a girl was studying in the Bible college. She went to the principal, who was Reverend Oral Roberts, and she went to the principal, said, I don't have time to read the Bible. And where is she studying? Oh, come on, where is she studying? She's studying in the Bible college. She says, I don't have any time to read the Bible because of all the assignments you give. By the time I get over with all my assignments, I don't have enough time to read the Bible. 24 hours is not enough for me. I cannot keep up with my work. For which the principal replied, starting tomorrow, you start with the Bible, and then you will realize that God will add time to whatever needs to be done in your life. So the girl started the reading or giving the Bible the first preference in her particular day. And what happened is this. You know, the work that will take 2 hours to complete, God gave her the wisdom, the ability, and the knowledge to get it completed in 1 hour. It is not that God will give you 25 hours, but he will help you to finish a work that will take longer in a shorter time, because God is going to work together with you. What I don't know, he knows. What I cannot do, he can do. What is not possible with me is possible with God. And when you give him the right preeminence in your life, let me tell you, that is the way to do the things of God in a godly way. Lift your hand and say a big amen to that. What happens with people sometimes? Early in the morning, the first thing they do is they read the paper. You know, headlines and then detailed news. After reading 16 pages of the paper, then you realize you haven't read the Bible. After reading 16 pages of, you know, worldly news, you come to the book of Proverbs. Not one single proverb will stick to your mind. Do you know why? Because there are already lots of things sticking to your mind. All from the front page to the last page, you have just kind of taken in all those news. There is no room for the Word of God. That is why the first thing that you ever do in life is to give the Word of God its rightful place. Amen. And what will take 5 hours for you to complete, God will give you the strength to do it in much shorter and in a blessed way. Lift your hand and say a big amen to that. So the Bible says you are doing a lot of things, but nothing is happening simply because you neglected the things of God and you are going about doing your own very thing. There was another example of D.L. Moody. And he came to the office one morning and the secretary said, you know, there are lots of appointments for you this morning. I want you to get cracking immediately. For which he replied, if there are lots of appointments, I need to pray lots. He said, ask them to come after 3 hours, because for all the work that needs to be done, you know, we need the strength of God. I was reading something yesterday where the man of God said it like this. How you want to do the work of God depends. You know, a lot depends on how you want to get the work of God done. If you want to get it done in an excellent way, then you will realize that you don't have the strength, you need the strength of God. If you have this in your mind, let me get about it some way, some other way, hook or crook, let me get it finished, then you will not be seeking God. You will be relying on your own understanding. That is why the Bible says, do not be wise in your own eyes. Do not lean on your own understanding, because there is a God about whom the Bible says he is the only wise God. He will help you to do things which is very difficult for you, and he will help you to do it through you, in you, by giving you the wisdom and the understanding that only he can give. If you are with me, say a big amen to that. You know, there are lots of things try to get our attention, whether you are in ministry or whether you are, you know, in any kind of job that God has placed you. There will always be a time where things are fighting to get its attention from you. And that is the time you need to remember Haggai. The Bible says, God says, consider your ways. Don't neglect the things of God, or don't do other things at the expense of neglecting godly things. That is not the right way to do. Diligence does not work like that. As I told you, it is doing the right thing and doing things right. I will say that again. It is doing the right thing and doing things right. And that is what will bring about progress in your life and in my life. What is the right thing to do in our life? The first thing, effectiveness. Come with me to 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 10. What is the right thing that needs to be done? Effectiveness. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 10, the Apostle Peter, you know, starting from verse 5 onwards, gives a big list of things that needs to be there for us to make progress. And summarizing that in verse 10, he says, therefore, brethren, be all the more diligent. Look at that word again. Be all the more diligent to make certain about your calling and your choosing. For as long as you practice these things, you will never stumble in life. I'm going to read it again for you. Therefore, brethren, sisters, everybody, be all the more diligent to make sure, to make certain about your calling and choosing. For as long as you practice these things, you will never stumble. In other words, what is Peter saying? Make sure for what God has called you. Remember the last verse of scripture last week? Paul says, I want to lay hold of that for which God has laid hold of me, and I will pursue towards that particular end. You know, when you are going to a particular place, for example, you know, using this, traveling as an example, you know, you were in a hurry and you went to the central bus station and you got on a bus. After being seated on the bus and the bus makes some way progress, then you suddenly realize, am I going to the right place? Is this bus going to the right place? So you want to go to E-Road. So you just got on a hurry. You did not kind of read the board in the front. You got on the bus. The bus is now in Avanashi Road. And you ask your neighbor, is this bus going to E-Road? And what does your neighbor say? Theriyad, paklirkan kele. No, he says, yes, it is going to E-Road. Immediately, you know, you feel some kind of consolation in your heart. Okay, I'm in the right bus. After some time, your mind says, what if he is wrong? You know, your neighbor. So immediately, what do? At that particular time, the conductor comes. So you ask the conductor, you know, is this bus going to E-Road? And he says, R-Road K. You know, it is going to E-Road only. No worries. So now you come to a place where you find rest in your heart, because you confirmed and you reconfirmed where you are going. And that is what happens in our life also. Sometimes when you go to bed in the night and when you are about to sleep, immediately a thought comes to your mind. Did I lock the front door? So what do? Kartar Patukar. No, you don't do that. When the thought comes, unless you settle that particular thought, you cannot go to sleep. So what do? You know, you moan and you whine and you get out of your bed and go there and you find it is locked. So now you come to your bed and now you can have a peaceful sleep. Now you have confirmed and reconfirmed that the door is locked. Did you lock the door before you come to church this morning? Did you lock the car? No worries. You just listen to the sermon. Okay? After you made sure that the door is locked, you are about to sleep again, your mind says, gas off pannama. Gas teendirichu. No problem whatsoever. Are you with me? So again, this thought comes up. Until you put that thought to rest, you will not have any kind of rest in your heart. This will keep coming up again and again and again until it is addressed properly according to God's word. And that is what Peter is saying. Make sure you're choosing and you're calling. Make sure, be sure that this is what God has called you for and this is what God has chosen you for. When you keep making sure what God has called you for, he says, then you will not stumble in your way. What is the right thing for you to do this very morning is to make sure the call of God that is upon your life. You know, you need to make it sure. You need to confirm it and you have to reconfirm it again in our life. When was Paul saying these words? I want to lay hold of that for which Christ has laid hold of me. It was not said at the start or the beginning of his ministry. It was said almost towards the end of his ministry. What is he saying? Did he run through all this time without having some kind of confirmation? No, no, no. What he's trying to say is this. As I'm holding on to the purposes of God, I want to continue to hold on to the purposes of God until the end. So what is diligence? It is making sure the call of God that is upon your life. I am doing what I am doing this morning. I'm called to do that. And that is what I'm doing. And it gives me joy that I'm doing what God has called me to do. Are you with me? Although, you know, sometimes it is very challenging. Sometimes you face difficult circumstances. But when you know that you're doing what God has called you to do, there is a peace that surpasses all understanding, that goes beyond the present problems, that goes beyond the present challenges. You know and you know and you know in your heart that you are there for a purpose, and that is what you are there doing it for the glory of God. You need to come to that particular position. If you are not there, I don't want you to feel worried. I don't want you to feel condemned this morning. God is here to give you help so that you can be in that particular place of confidence. Come with me to Jeremiah chapter 6 and verse 16. Again, talking to the people who are wandering in their ways. This is the prophet Jeremiah through whom God wants to bring clarity into their circumstances. Jeremiah chapter 6 and verse 16. The Bible says, thus says the Lord, stand by the ways and see, ask for the ancient paths, where the good way is, and walk in it, and you shall find rest for your soul. You know, it cannot be any more clearer than this particular verse of scripture. What does the prophet say? He says, stand by the ways and see and ask. In other words, don't just keep on going or keep on moving. Just be there, stand still. Remember, the Bible says, be still and know that I am God. If you are keep doing what you are doing, you will only keep getting what you are getting. That's what will happen. If you continue in this space, you know, it will lead you to something that is very undesirable. So the Bible says you need to stand. It's like more like going to find a place that you do not know. You know, you're driving and you go to a particular place, you don't know the direction, and you ask for direction. Very simple way of doing it. But many people think, I will not ask for directions. I will go to the same place round and round and round and again. I will find it for myself. I will not ask anybody else. That is a waste of time. You know, you let go of your ego and you stop, you humble yourself, and you need to ask God, Lord, am I going the right way? And when God says, no, you're not, you make a U-turn. Say that word with me. You make a what? That is what is called repentance. Repentance is making a U-turn. It is making a change in our direction. If you want to make progress in life, you need to stand this morning. And the Bible says, stand, ask, see, ask for the path, find the good way, and you walk in it. And only then you will find rest for your soul. There are, in our experience, you will go to do certain thing, and even though things are happening around you, deep inside you know there is something wrong. There is something missing. There is something, you know, that is not there where it should be. It is those times that God says you need to stand there. You know, don't do anything. Just stand there. Be in the presence of God and find out the right path and then walk in it. The Bible says, then you will find rest for your soul. If you're frustrated this morning, frustrated with life, frustrated with your work, frustrated in your relationship with God, with other people, in your marriage, whatever that might be, the Bible says you need to stand still. God wants to give you rest, but you need to find out and walk in the path that has been marked out for you. Say a big amen to that. Amen. You know, don't continue in that particular kind of way of doing things. You know, some to use the very simple expression, we say if he continues in that range, you know, I don't think it will work out well for him. That is the same thing that is said in the Bible also. Don't just continue for the sake of doing it, but rather take time. Month of prayer is a time where you take time to be in the presence of God to find out whether you are doing what God has called you to do. And when you know for sure, let me encourage you, go in full speed, because God is with you and he will cause things to prosper in your hand. Lift your hand and say a big amen to that. Somebody said it like this: if you do not know what to do, don't do. You understand that? If you do not know what to do, don't do it, because you do not know what to do. And even if you kind of assume certain things and kind of go ahead with it, and then you will feel very, very sorry for what you have done in your life. The Bible says, stand, be still. Say that word with me: be still. In other words, what is the amplified expression of that? Cease from your own strivings, you know, and just be in the presence of God, because you are being in the presence of the Almighty God with whom all things are possible, you know, and give up your kind of fretting and just be in the presence of God, knowing that he is in control of all things. Lift your hand and say a big amen. Whatever is frustrating you this morning, let me encourage, be still and know that he is God and he is in full control. Hallelujah. What is beyond my control is within God's control. I will say that again. What is beyond my control is within God's control. So instead of trying to control, I should believe in the sovereign control of God. And that's what will give you rest. You know, instead of worrying about, you know, I haven't done that, I don't know what they will say, I don't know what he's going to come up with, I don't know what they are going to say. Don't worry about all that. In simple terms, put your faith in God who controls all things. The Bible says he will guide the hearts of kings like channels of water. You know, I will say that word again. He will guide the hearts of kings like what? Like channels of water. Instead of trying to manipulate that guy, you put your trust in God and God will bring about a miracle in your life. And that is how to make progress in our Christian walk. Lift your hand and say a big amen to that. Somebody said it like this, I remember. When you cease manipulating, miracles will happen. I will say that again. When you cease manipulating, miracles will happen. Because manipulating, you do, miracles, God does. What is the difference between magic and miracle? Are you with me? Magic is what I can do whenever I want, however I want. Miracle is not within my control. It is what God does, whenever he does. And the Bible says he makes all things beautiful in his time. Stop manipulating and let the word of God bring about a miracle in your life. You know, don't be anxious. Don't be fretting about things. Things that are beyond your control, don't worry about it. God is in control. Say that word aloud with me. God is in control. Ayyo, apdi pandran. Don't worry. God is in control. You know, and when you come to that place of assurance, knowing that you are doing what God has called you to do, that is when progress begins to take place in your life. So what is the right thing that you need to do in diligence? Number one is to make sure the calling and the choosing of God in your life. Come into 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 2. There is another important thing that we always have to do. Doing the right thing. What is that? 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 2. Paul says to Timothy, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort, and with great patience and instruction. The first two lines is what we are going to give our attention. Preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. In other words, preaching, it's not just for preachers. You can say proclamation or professing the word of God. Confession is another good word. Confess the word of God, whether it is season or not in season, whether it is favorable or unfavorable. The Bible says, Paul says, you need to keep confessing the word of God. This is the right thing for you to do. I will say that again. Number one is to make sure you are called. Number two is to make sure that you confess the word of God in your life. How does confession work? You need to understand. You know, many times we might have heard lots and lots of sermons about confession, and some people, they think, you know, if I get a book where it contains 5,000 stotrams and things like that, and I go through the book, by before I finish the book, everything will be all right. You know, some people have that. So they go through the book as soon as sotra, 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 sotram, they finish it and nothing has happened. No, it doesn't work like that. The Bible gives you a wonderful example in Isaiah chapter 55, verse 10 and verse 11. Verse 10 talks about what happens in the natural. The natural, this is what happens. The rain comes and the ground gets wet, and then the seed goes inside, and then the growth begins to happen. And the Bible says, as in the natural, so in the spiritual, so will my word be which goes out of my mouth. First, it will get the heart or the soil wet. Then the seed goes inside. Then the Lord brings a harvest. Then your life will begin to change. What am I trying to get at this morning? You know, first, the land has to get what? It has got to get wet. So if somebody is saying, I've been confessing it for 5 days and nothing has really happened, let me tell you, it has been dry for 5 years. And for that dry land to get wet, it will take more than 5 days. If you are with me, you will win. You know, after 5 days of confessing, people will come and say, I've done it for 5 days, nothing has happened, this doesn't work for me, so I'm not going to confess anymore. No, this is working already. Tell your neighbor, it is working. Oh, it is working. You know, for 5 years, you never mentioned God's word from your mouth. All we were saying, we were giving out opinions of other people. We have just started. It has started drizzling. Remember the song, mercy drops us are falling, but for the showers, we plead. It is only started to rain. The moment you begin to confess, the Bible says, just as rain comes and drenches the land, so is my word that goes forth from my mouth. It's like going to the doctor. There are wonderful doctors here. You take the tablet, the moment you swallow it, inga valiye poliye. No, it has to go inside. And then it has to, you know, the system has to operate. After 15 or 20 minutes, then the medicine will start to work, and then the pain will start to ease. You know, the moment you swallow, the pain doesn't stop. Ningala enga padichinga kaas kudutha vaangninga. You understand what I'm... No, they did the hard work. I have great appreciation for doctors. You know, doctors are like pastors. You understand? We are all in the healing business. You know, and it takes long time of study and kind of being patient with people and so on. And they want instant results, just like that. The moment pastor lays his hand upon them, you know, everything should be changed. You know, I went and prayed. I took my wife to get prayed by the pastor. After the prayer was finished, I got a new wife. I can see what you're thinking. You know, it doesn't work like that way. Even after I pray or anybody comes and prays, ellar jomani oru prayojanam illa maatrame illa. No, changes are happening inside. It will slowly the change will come. But when you don't understand the mechanics of it, if we will do it for 1 week or we will do it for 2 days, after 2 days we'll stop doing it all. Because we come to the wrong conclusion, it is not working. Let me tell you, it is already at work. Remember the time when we had plenty of empty chairs in the English service. You know, those times, you can come, even at 10:15, you'll get a chair. No problem. Well, somebody said, I've been coming to this church for 15 years. What will you give me? Take the chair that you've been seated there for 15 years. You know? That's all we can give. It was like that. But we kept confessing, God is going to bring people. One day it's going to come. If you come late for the English service, you will not get a seat. It's getting partially fulfilled now. It will come to its full fulfillment. One fine day, you know, when you come late, you will not get a seat. God is at work now. There is plenty of people here. There is plenty more to come. They will come when they see you being blessed. They will also will come. This will happen after we've been speaking the word for I don't know how many years, but constantly. At one point, I came to the point, let's cancel the English service altogether. You know, Tamil service, much more nicer people, no? You don't get me wrong. You understand that. You know, instead of, you know, trying to get encouraging this small group of people, ask them to come to the Tamil service. They all know Tamil anyway. So what is the whole point? Actually, we can clap our hands in a faster way in the Tamil service, and we can sing songs. You know, that is much more kind of exuberant. We can go about. And then on that particular Sunday, when I thought that we should be cancelling our English service, few new people came. Good people they are. They came at the right time, said the right things, you know, and that encouraged me to move forward. Praise God, God is always ahead. His word will always come to pass. And you confess words about your children, you confess words about your work, you confess words about different things that God has given into your life. And when it apparently seems that it is not working, don't come to the wrong conclusion. Let me give you the right conclusion. It is already working. As the rain comes and drenches the land first, and then the seed goes inside, then comes the mighty harvest. Tell your neighbor, don't give up. Oh, don't give up, don't give up. You know, you prayed for some of the things, and when those things never happened as you expected, immediately you thought, you know, oh, I'm going to stop praying altogether. Let me give you an example that comes to my mind. You know, you are in a hurry, so you go to a house and you press the calling bell in a hurry. Okay? You are in a hurry, you are pressing the calling bell in a hurry. The person who wants to answer the call is not in a hurry. You remember what I'm saying? Ding dong. You know, the moment you do that, you are expecting them, somebody to open. No, that somebody is already in another work. They are engaged in some other work. They heard your call and they took their time because it is their house. You remember that? It is their house. So they take their time and they come and open the door. You understand that? We did not wait for them. So we just went off thinking there is nobody at home. There was somebody at home. They heard your calling bell and they are there to open the door, but we did not have that much patience to wait till the door opens. Jesus says, to everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Amen. What it simply means is, keep knocking until the door is open. I don't know what kind of calling bell you have it in your home, but there is a calling bell with a ding dong. Some people press the ding and never come to the dong. That is one way of getting the owner to come quickly. You understand what I'm saying? Sometimes it's like that, you know, and we think people are not there. God has not heard my prayer. What is the point of me praying? What is the point of me confessing? Nothing seems to be happening on the visible side of things. But let me encourage you, it is getting ready. It is getting drenched. The seed has already gone inside. The incorruptible seed, which is the word of God, it will always come to its fruition because it is God and it is word. It will never fail. Lift your hand and say a big amen to that. So the Bible says, you know, whether it is favorable or whether it is not favorable, I want you to preach the word of God. I want you to confess the word of God in your life. The Bible says, do not be anxious of anything, but make all your prayers known unto God. Then the peace of God that surpasseth all understanding will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. The word I would like to underline is the word then. Then the peace of God that surpasseth all understanding. When is the question? When you have made all your anxious thoughts known unto God. Putting it in another way. Until the peace that surpasseth all understanding comes and guards your heart, do not give up praying. Do not give up talking to God. Do not give up reading the word of God. Sometimes when you're going through a hard time, when you read the Bible, nothing seems to stick to you. Have you come across those times when you are going through very hard, difficult times, and you open the Bible, part of your mind is reading the Bible, the other part of your mind is still calculating how to calculate that guy. You understand that? Because it is so difficult. That's a present need that has to be addressed immediately. And you are reading the word of God, nothing seems to stick to you. Maybe you are going through a hard time of bereavement, or going through a very hard time of soul being going through the darkest night of the soul, to use the expression. And nothing seems to be working. But let me tell you, even when you are going through the valley of shadow of death, remember God is with you. You may not understand what you read is still there in your mind, but when the right time comes, the Holy Spirit brings to your conscious mind what is there in your heart, and he will bring it to your remembrance. It is through that word that you will be able to overcome. Hallelujah. Don't give up. Say that word out loud with me. Don't give up. Sometimes when you begin to pray for people, that is when they go from bad to worse. And the devil will tell you, before you prayed, he was all right. Now you started praying, he is getting worse. But remember, it is working. It will go worse and then it will come better. கொஞ்சம் வண்டி பின்னாடி போயிட்டு அப்புறம் இட் வில் கம் ஃபார்வர்ட் யூ நோ தே வில் சே நோ 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 அண்ட் டோன்ட் கம் டு தி கன்க்ளூஷன் நோ இட்ஸ் நாட் ஒர்க்கிங் ஐ எம் கோயிங் டு ஸ்டாப் ப்ரேயிங் நோ தி ப்ரேயர்ஸ் ஆர் ஹர்ட் தி பைபிள் சேஸ் திஸ் இஸ் த கான்ஃபிடன்ஸ் தட் வி ஹேவ் இன் கிரைஸ்ட் தட் வென் வி ப்ரே ஹீ ஹியர்ஸ் அவர் ப்ரேயர் ஐ எம் கோயிங் டு சே தட் அகைன் திஸ் இஸ் த கான்ஃபிடன்ஸ் தட் வி ஹேவ் தட் வென் வி ப்ரே ஹீ ஹியர்ஸ் our prayers. When we were growing up, I have come across sermons where the preacher said it like this: your prayer will not even go over the roof. I thought then you have to raise your voice so that your prayer will reach heaven. Then when you read the word of God, I began to realize my prayer does not have to reach the roof, because the one who hears my prayer is not on the roof, it is inside my heart. That is why the Bible says even before a word comes out of your mouth, the Lord knows your need. Never give up. Say a big amen to that. What is the right thing that we have to do? Number one is to confirm your call. Number two is to begin to be steadfast in your confession. The Bible says, let the weak say. Oh, let him speak the truth. Let the weak say, I am strong. It seems contradictory. You know, you are asking me to say something that I am not. No, all we are saying is we are asking you to say what God has already said it. So the Bible says, let the weak say, I am strong. And the word of God will bring the strength that is needed and necessary in your life. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 7. What is the right thing to do? Number one is to confirm your call. Number two is to be steadfast in your confession. Number three is 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 7. The Bible says, the end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be of a sound mind, or be diligent with the purpose of prayer. Number three is never give up. As I've been saying it again, never give up prayer in your life, because prayer will change things. Your prayers are all heard by God, and God is already moving things in your favor. All you need to do is just, you are on the brink of a miracle. Are you with me? You know, some people say it like this: God is not doing anything for me. How do you know he is not doing anything for you? You do not know all things, do you? Are you with me? We do not know what is happening behind the scene. All we can see is what we can see with our natural eyes, and we come to the conclusion God is not doing anything. Let me encourage you this morning. What God is doing, your eye has not seen, your ear has not heard, nor has it entered your mind, what God has already prepared for those who love him. Do you love God this morning? Let me tell you, it is already been prepared. So the point here is this: be diligent for the purpose of prayer. Let me use the example of an aircraft. The moment the aircraft leaves the ground, or even when it is on the ground, it is always in constant connection with what? The air traffic controllers. Are you with me? I'm sure you are aware of that. You know, they are in constant control. Even as they are taking off, even as their flight is in its rightful path, they are always constantly in communication with air traffic control. The moment there is no communication from the aircraft, immediately the people who are in control of the air traffic, they will make sure that they will get a response from the aircraft. And I was kind of watching a documentary about the flight that disappeared and how the nitty-gritties of things. And the moment there was no response from the aircraft, they took all the efforts to get the communication back, because if there is no communication, we do not know where they are heading towards. And we know the result of it, very, very kind of grieving to our heart. But the whole point is this: as long as you are alive, be in constant communion with God. You need to be in constant communion with air traffic control. Hallelujah. Some people, you call them and the phone says, Todarbi ellaki veliye irukkar. You understand? He is, what is the English? Do they say it in English? You know, what do they say? He's beyond, out of coverage. Sunday is on coverage. மண்டே டு சாட்டர்டே தொடர்பு எல்லைக்கு வெளியே போயிட்டார். தட் இஸ் வெரி டேஞ்சரஸ். யூ அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட், வென் ஆல் டேஸ் ஆஃப் த வீக் யூ ஷுட் பி இன் கவரேஜ். ஏன்னா டு புட் இட் இன் அனதர் வே, யூ கெனாட் கனா ரன் அவே ஃப்ரம் காட். யூ நோ டேவிட் வித்வுட் எனி செல்ஃபோன்ஸ் ஈ நியூ தட் ஈ வாஸ் சேயிங் டு வேர்ட்ஸ் டு திஸ் எஃபெக்ட், ஈவன் இஃப் ஐ கோ டு தி ஹேடிஸ் ஸ்டில் தேர் இஸ் சிக்னல். யூ அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் வாட் ஐ எம் சேயிங். ஈவன் இஃப் ஐ டேக் தி விங்ஸ் ஆஃப் அ பேர்ட் அண்ட் கோ டு த ரிமோட்டஸ்ட் பார்ட் ஆஃப் தி எர்த், ஸ்டில் தேர் இஸ் அ ரிங் டோன், தேர் இஸ் அ சிக்னல். யூ கெனாட் ரன் அவே ஃப்ரம் காட். ஐ வாஸ் திங்கிங் அபவுட் இட். It's more like when children play hide and seek. You remember? So they kind of calculate that this is how the guy is coming. So they want to overtake him and they run towards that particular direction. Avan romba vevaram. What he will do, he will say it from the other side, coming, and he will come this way. So instead of running away from that guy, you are doing what? Running. When you run away from God, you will run towards God. You cannot run away from God. Are you with me? All the thing that is needed this morning is that you need to be online. Some people are online all the time. 3:45 in the morning, WhatsApp la message varudhu. You know, 5 o'clock in the morning, they are online on Facebook. Are you with me? All the time, 24 hours, they are online. You know, we appreciate you in one sense and only in one sense. You understand what I'm trying to say? In the same way, you have to be online with God all the time. Some of you have switched the phone off. Are you with me? Because you thought, what is the point of praying? I am not getting any answer. What does the Bible say? Call unto me. Oh, come on, call unto me. And I will answer. I will make known to you things that are beyond you. Things that you do not understand. I will make it known to you. And the right thing that we have to do in our diligence is to make sure of our call, to make sure of our confession, and to make sure that we are constantly in communication with God. Never give up prayer. Tell your neighbor, never. Never give up prayer. You know, prayer is very simple. You can pray wherever you are, whenever you are, and it is all very, very conducive. But make sure you pray. And there is a constant way of keeping in communion with God. The Bible says, pray without. Oh, come on, pray without ceasing. I've said it many times, I will say it again. How many of you are breathing this morning? We are all breathing. The moment I said breathing, that is when you became conscious of what you are doing. And even when I don't mention that particular word, you are still breathing. Same thing applies to prayer. When we say, let's pray, and we consciously come to the position of prayer. When the amen is pronounced, it doesn't mean prayer has come to an end. Amen is just a way of saying prayer has come to an end. Now you can continue with your prayer until you see him face to face. Hallelujah. So when the service is finished, it is finished here. But you continue to serve God throughout your life. If you are with me, say a big amen to that. That is why the Bible says, I was asleep, but my heart was awake, but my spirit was searching the innermost things of God. I went to bed with a problem. I woke up with a solution because the Spirit of God is breathing in and through my life and bringing about the necessary change that needs to happen in my life. Lift your hand and say a big amen to that. We have come to the end of our time. I'm going to give you a few scriptures. Just make a note of it. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 13 to 14. Efficiency is doing things right or doing it right all the time. Two things are necessary. You need to give your attention. You should not be neglecting the work of or the gift of God that is upon your life. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 1. If you give up your attention, you will drift away. Luke's Gospel chapter 15. Luke's Gospel chapter 15 verse 8. Perseverance. You know, until you find it, you keep doing what you are called to do. The example is of a lady who lost her coin in her house. And Jesus gives that example. What does she do? She immediately lights the candle, she sweeps the house, and she diligently seeks for it until she finds it. Keep doing what God has called you to do until promotion comes your way. Are you with me? David was singing songs, he was writing songs, he was singing songs, he was playing the instrument. Who was the audience? Nobody was the audience. Yes, God was there. He had lots of sheep in front of him. He sings a new song, part of it. Very good. That's the only audience he had. Namma pata ba. You understand? Right, that was the only audience he had. Nobody to appreciate him. Nobody to say, that's a good song. Tell me the chord progression. There's nobody there. He just keep singing songs. You know, he was just faithful and tending the sheep and so on. One fine day, his name gets mentioned in the palace. Somebody says to Saul, there is one guy by the name of David, and he plays the harp so skillfully. When he comes and plays, you will be healed of your malady. That's what he said. How did he knew that David was playing? David did not knew that there was an audience. The right people will listen to your work. The right people will see the work that you do. At the right time, your name will get mentioned. The Bible says, if you see a man who is diligent in his work, he will not stand before obscure men, but he will stand before kings. And one fine day, we are all going to stand before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we need to hear these wonderful words coming out of the mouth of God saying, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter your master's rest. That is what diligence can do in your life. I will say that particular word. And once again, if you see a man diligent in his work, he will not stand before obscure men. He will not stand work in an obscure environment, in an obscure place. But he will stand before kings. And we are all going to stand before the King of Kings. One fine day, let's be diligent in what God has called us to do. We will move from where we are to where God wants us to be. Amen. Let's all stand to our feet as we look to God in prayer. Praise God. Every eye closed as we look to God in prayer. Confirm your call. Be confident in your confession. And be constantly in communication with God. And do and continue to serve God wherever God has placed you. No, it doesn't matter whether people are appreciating or listening to you, looking at you. God is always watchful of you. Do what is right and keep doing it. The Bible says you will stand before the King of Kings one day. God will bring about the right kind of promotion that He has already planned and designed for you. Never give up praying. Never give up, because things are not the way they need to be according to your own idea. Lift your hand and give thanks to God, because we have a God who is the rewarder of those who seek Him diligently. Hallelujah. Lift your hand and worship God. Hallelujah. Be the fire in my heart. Be the wind in the sails. Be the reason that I live. Let us